Pregnancy and cardiopathy is obviously an important field because it's a field with continual improvement in technology, with a lot of ethical issues behind, and we have the enormous opportunity to, with a bigger speaker, if you want to introduce the speaker, so you will feel expertise. Thank you.
Okay, so for me, it's a great pleasure to introduce the, Professor Ross Hetzling. She's the director of the ACHD program in the Erasmus Medical Center in Rotterdam. She's also the president of the working group of the Adult Congenital Heart Disease of the European Society of Cardiology. And also she's a member of the international board of the European Heart Journal. And she is the co-chair of the ROPAC registry. This is a registry that has been recording data from more than 60 countries on pregnancy in patients with congenital heart disease and also with cardiac conditions in general, and has published more than 20 papers now on this topic, so we cannot have a better speaker for that topic. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mrs. Chairpersons, Chairwomen. I would like to thank Antonia and Mila for inviting me to come to Spain. I think it's one of the most beautiful countries. To come to Barcelona, one of my favorite cities, and to this beautiful old university with this fantastic aula. And I would like to congratulate the organizers for this fantastic program. So it's a great honor to be here. And then I can talk about my hobby, pregnancy and heart disease. So this is a good day for me. And because this is the last session and everybody will be quite tired, I thought I'd start with a patient. So this is a woman, and this happened already a couple of years ago, but she presented at my outpatient clinic. She was sent to me by the obstetrician, and she's 20 weeks pregnant. And she's known with Marfan syndrome, as is her mother, and she hadn't seen a doctor in the last 10 years. She's no complaint since she's employed as a school teacher at looking care of younger children. So, of course, we were a little bit surprised that she hadn't seen a doctor before pregnancy. So immediately we did an echo, and luckily this was okay. So my question to you is, what would you advise her? Do you see her more often during pregnancy? Do you do a normal delivery? What is your advice? What do you think? Anybody? You would do an MRI. Why? Yeah, very good. I think indeed for the Marfan patients, we need imaging of the whole aorta, not only the ascending aorta. And we know now MRI is safe during pregnancy, so you can do that. And we did, and I was called by the radiologist to come immediately because this woman has a type B aortic dissection. So I came running into the radiology department, and the scan of the ascending aorta was normal, but the diameter of the descending aorta was 52 with a type B dissection. So I asked her, do you have any complaints? No, she had no complaints. She had no pain. She didn't have any complaints the last week. Actually, she came by bike to the hospital to have this MRI scan. So what would you do now? She's now 22 weeks pregnant. What would you advise her? Any idea?
I would call Arturo, evangelista.
What company is today?
Well, I think the first thing that we did is to look in the guidelines, and at that time that were the 2011 guidelines, and these were the advices. Most dissection occur in the last trimester or the weeks after delivery. The larger the diameter, the higher the risk. An aortic diameter of more than 4 or an increase in diameter are risk factors during pregnancy, and if you have a type B dissection, you should be advised against pregnancy. So this is not so helpful in this situation. Well, we know that pregnancy is an additional risk factor. You have, due to the hormonal changes, you have differences, especially in the elastic fibers and in the collagen. And this is, of course, necessary for the pregnancy, but it also has a negative impact on the wall of the aorta and a higher risk of dissection during pregnancy. But we do not know if this dissection occurred the last day or maybe 9 years ago. So we admitted her to the hospital. We put her first on the ICU, but she did fine. She had no complaints. We managed her with aggressive blood pressure management with beta blockers, and we followed her with echo and MRI, but she did well. So after 1 week in the ICU, we said, well, you can go to the cardiology ward. And 2 weeks later, she was still stable, so we sent her to the obstetric ward. And, well, she did fine. So what would be your next step? What would you do with the delivery? What would be the timing that you would wait? Difficult. There's nobody who knows. So we finally decided to do a C-section at 34 weeks, and we thought we were just having a good situation. The baby was doing well and was growing, and well, the mother did fine, and the baby was also okay. So we were lucky. But 2 years later, this patient had no complaints, but on the CT scan, we saw that the aortic arch increased in diameter, and also the descending aorta increased in diameter. So we had to do a operation, and we did a resection of the aneurysm with interposition of a vascular tech prosthesis, and this was uncomplicated. 2 years later, she presented in the emergency room with a collapse, so we did a CT scan, and now she had a dissection of the ascending aorta. She went for surgery, and this was also uncomplicated, and now, last week, I saw her, and now she wants another baby. So what would you advise? Okay, so, sorry? So I had the privilege of chairing the ESC guidelines who were presented in 2018 together with Vera Rigitz on the management of cardiovascular disease during pregnancy. And I think this is a very difficult guidelines because you probably know that you have the classes of recommendation and you have the level of evidence. And the level of evidence, C, means that there is only consensus of opinion of experts, retrospective studies, and registries. So for the pregnancy guidelines, we only had level of C evidence. So we really need more trials, and I would like to ask all of you to study pregnancy. Well, we do know that pregnancy has important hemodynamic implications. The cardiac output increase up to 40 to 50%, and the highest rise in cardiac output is at the end of the second trimester. First, there is an increase in stroke volume, and at the end of the pregnancy, there is an increase in heart rate. And during the contractions, you have another 25% increase in cardiac output. So during pregnancy, all cardiac patients have a higher risk of heart failure, arrhythmias, and dissection. And this is a nice study from the UK where all women who die during pregnancy or directly after delivery have to be signed in for this by the government organized confidential inquiry. And cardiac disease is the leading cause of maternal death. So really, we need to address this important topic. So what is the advice? I think in all women known with cardiac disease, we do have to do a good preconceptional counseling based on good imaging, echocardiography, and exercise tests. And the VO2 max is, of course, very important in these women. And we do know that peak heart rate and oxygen uptake are predictors for maternal cardiac events. If you have an exercise capacity over 80%, you have a good chance of also having a favorable outcome of pregnancy. So this is a very easy test to do before pregnancy. And of course, in aortic patients, we do need advanced imaging, preferably before pregnancy. And of course, you should also talk about genetic counseling. Maybe you have to change the medication. We do know that ACE inhibitors and ARBs are not allowed during pregnancy because of fetal toxic effects, and also anticoagulants has to be discussed timely. About genetics, of course you can do the investigations during pregnancy, and these are very well established and accepted, but now you also have the possibility of pre-gestational diagnostics. So on forehand you can do testing, select an embryo, and put the selected embryo back. This is important for women, for instance, with Marfan or Turner syndrome or other autosomal dominant disorders. But there are some ethical aspects to this. So for instance, if you have a woman with a vascular Ehlers-Danlos, which is a contraindication for pregnancy, and she decided still to want to become pregnant, and she wants to do this pre-gestational diagnostics, what would you advise? Is this a possibility because she's really not allowed to become pregnant, but she chooses to become pregnant? Are we going to help her to do this genetic possibility? So these are new problems that arise. In some cases, we do pre-pregnancy interventions, but this is rare. Only this is done for severe aortic dilatation or severe mitral stenosis, because we do know that mitral stenosis have a high risk of getting into problem during pregnancy, so it's much better to deal with this before pregnancy. For the risk estimation, the new guidelines advise the WHO classification. I'll show you this in a moment. And very new is the pregnancy heart team. The pregnancy heart team has to be used for two important things. First, if you have a high-risk pregnancy wish, so before pregnancy, it can be discussed in this team, and it will be a team discussion what is the advice to this couple. And secondly, during pregnancy, so between 20 and 25 weeks, the pregnancy heart team can be used to define the best way of the delivery. Where should it take place? Should it be a cesarean section or a vaginal delivery? How long should the woman stay in the hospital? Because also the time directly after delivery is a high-risk period. So these are very important things, and you have to make a written plan, and it should be available 24 hours, 7 days a week, so everybody knows what is the plan. In this pregnancy heart team, we need at least a cardiologist, an obstetrician, and an anesthesiologist, but of course, in some issues, other specialists are also very important. The WHO classification, class one means there's not a high risk, not even increased risk. Class two is a little bit increased risk. Class 3 is high risk, and class 4 means a contraindication for pregnancy. So in the guidelines, we now have these large schemes explaining what to do for a woman in a specific risk category. So for instance, if you are in a class 3, this is high risk, the event rate is about 20 to 30%, and in class 4, this is 40 to 100% risk of having an event during pregnancy. So that means that for class 3, we advise expert counseling, and of course also for class 4, but then even termination should be discussed. And the care and the delivery should take place in the expert center in these high-risk patients. And also in the guidelines is this table with all the diagnoses, because this classification is based on the underlying diagnosis. But of course, you have to take into account the severity of the diagnosis. So for instance, if you have a moderate impairment in left ventricular function of 30 to 45%, this is a high risk. While when the ejection fraction is below 30%, this is a contraindication for pregnancy. And also for instance, for WHO class 4, you have to really advise the women against pregnancy. These, I think everybody has to know, because these women should be advised already at young age that pregnancy is not advised. So this is Fontan patients with pulmonary arterial hypertension, severe systemic ventricular dysfunction, severe coarctation, systemic right ventricle with decreased ventricular function, severe aortic dilatation or history of dissection, severe mitral stenosis, severe aortic stenosis who are all symptomatic or have an impaired LV function or a pathological exercise test, and patients with a peripartum cardiomyopathy where the ventricle did not completely normalize. So what about during pregnancy? Well, at least all women with congenital or possibly genetic heart disease should offer fetal echocardiography because you also have the risk that the baby will have heart disease. And if you have a pregnant patient with complaints, I think there should be a low threshold to perform echocardiography. And then a delivery plan should be made between 20 and 30 weeks. And for anticoagulation, this is a specific and very difficult topic. Low molecular weight heparins can be used, but then you have to also can do anti-10A levels. What about the delivery? In the new guidelines, it is advised that the pregnancy should not have a duration more than 40 weeks. So every pregnancy has to be delivered at 40 weeks. There's no advantage of a longer pregnancy while the risks are there. So this is completely new. And a vaginal delivery is advised for most patients. Only for some, a cesarean section is advised. And this is in preterm labor in patients with oral anticoagulants. And this is because the fetus is then at risk of having hemorrhage in the head, cerebral hemorrhage. If you have aggressive aortic pathology, cesarean section is advised, acute intractable heart failure, and severe forms of pulmonary hypertension. And endocarditis prophylaxis is not any longer recommended following the new guidelines. So the ROPAC study, I told you already, there are no randomized trials, and it's very difficult to do a randomized trial in pregnancy because there are many ethical issues. It's very difficult, and many women are not motivated to participate in a trial when they are pregnant. So that's why I started together with Professor Roger Hall from London in the UK, this prospective registry. And we started with a few patients and everybody was enthusiastic because everybody had a few patients. And we thought by collecting, by combining our data, we finally would have some answers to our questions. So finally, from 53 countries and 138 participating centers, we could enroll 5,700 women with heart disease who were pregnant in a prospective manner. So most patients had congenital heart defects, a quarter had valvular heart disease, but we also had patients with cardiomyopathy, ischemic heart disease, aortic pathology, and pulmonary arterial hypertension. So my question to you is this maternal mortality higher or lower than you expected? So in the overall ROPAC registry, we found a maternal mortality of 0.6%. This is higher than expected, 100 times higher than in the background, normal pregnancy without heart disease. But in my opinion, it is not that high. It was a little bit better than I expected, actually. Heart failure occurred in 11% of the women and arrhythmias 4%. So we looked into the diagnosis, and what of the diagnosis do you think will have the highest maternal mortality? So who will think it is congenital heart disease? We will just do it by arm raise. Congenital heart disease? Nobody. Who thinks valvular heart disease is worst? Cardiomyopathy? Three, ischemic heart disease, aortic pathology, and pulmonary hypertension. So indeed, pulmonary hypertension had a maternal mortality rate of 9%. So 1 in 10 women died. So these are the women with the highest risk. And it was already elucidated in an earlier talk today, and I think this is a very important message that all these women really should be advised not to become pregnant. Heart failure occurred also most often in the pulmonary arterial hypertension group, but also in a third of the patients or in a quarter of the patients with cardiomyopathy and also in valvular heart disease. And arrhythmias were not that often, but most often seen in valvular heart disease. And of course, this is normal. This is especially patients with mitral stenosis, often developing atrial fibrillation or supraventricular tachycardias. We also looked for predictors for maternal mortality or heart failure, and we found that this is all for the baseline characteristics, that a higher New York Heart Association class before pregnancy, or a lower systemic ejection fraction, the use of anticoagulation, the higher WHO classification, and clinical signs of heart failure. These were the predictors for a bad outcome. What about obstetric and fetal outcome? This is, of course, also very important. And also here, pulmonary arterial hypertension was the worst group. And in 50%, there were fetal or neonatal complications, like small for gestational age, birth weight, but also neonatal mortality. So this is really bad news. We also looked in the specific WHO classifications about risks, and we found that in WHO classification 4, indeed the highest risk of 50% were seen, most often arrhythmias and especially heart failure. And as you can see, this is the group that should not become pregnant, but still we had many women that do become pregnant. So we can advise them not to, but in the end, the women decide. So I think it's also a very important advice that if you say you should not become pregnant, you still have the conversation and the communication with your patient. And if she decides to become pregnant, that you should still be there to guide her during pregnancy, because otherwise she will do it on her own, and that's even worse, I think. So when does heart failure occur? We also looked into that in the ROPAC study, and we found that especially at the end of the second trimester and during directly after delivery, there was a peak in the incidence of heart failure. And of course, if you look into this hemodynamic scheme, that is not surprising, because as I told you already, at the end of the second trimester, we have the highest cardiac output. And in the new guidelines, there is this scheme, how to treat heart failure. Some medication you can use and other medication you should not use. And of course, during pregnancy, you have to be very careful with the use of diuretics. They are not fetal toxic, but you have to take care that you do not hydrate the woman. And other medication, like digoxin, I think, what would you do with digoxin in pregnancy? Can we use it? Anybody? Yes, we can. It's safe, but we have to give more, because you have higher weight and a higher percentage in the tissues. So you have to give more digoxin during pregnancy than outside pregnancy. So therefore, it's very important that you know about medication use during pregnancy. It's always different. And these are all in these guidelines, and it's also a very important link to a up-to-date website where you can find all the information on medication and also during breastfeeding. So we also looked in more detail in the women with congenital heart disease, and we made a difference with a focus on the uncorrected women. And here you can see this is quite a busy slide, but what you can see is that in the patients with uncorrected heart disease, they were more often from an emerging country. And of course, this is not surprising. And we had 29 women with Eisenmenger with pregnancy. So this was a very important group, because there was no good literature on this before. So what we found is that in the uncorrected congenital heart disease, maternal mortality was 0.7%. So this is clearly higher than in the corrected women, but still not very high. And also we saw more endocarditis, especially in the women with a shunt lesion. And here you can see the cardiovascular outcome for the uncorrected women in the emerging versus developing countries. And you can clearly see that hospital admission was more often seen in the women from an emerging country. And also heart failure was more often encountered in the emerging countries. But when we corrected for the underlying diagnosis, then there was no difference anymore. And for the obstetric complications, we found that cesarean section was more often seen in the women from an emerging country. And here we looked into more detail in cyanosis. In green are the women with cyanosis, and this is the total group, and here from developed and undeveloped countries. And here you can see clearly that the women with cyanosis do worse compared to the women without cyanosis. And then a very specific group, the Fontan women. We didn't have much data on that in the ROPAC, but there were some other studies in the literature. And I think these are very high-risk pregnancies, and especially also the risk of miscarriage is very high. Because this was a study looking in women with Fontan who wanted to become pregnant, and nearly half of them never conceived. So there may be also fertility issues. They could not become pregnant, maybe because of the hemodynamics, maybe because of other reasons. So nearly half never became pregnant, although they wished they wanted to become pregnant. And a quarter only had miscarriages, and only a third of the women actually had a live birth. So I think we really have to counsel our women with Fontan about this high risk of miscarriage and unsuccessful pregnancies. And when they did become pregnant, they had also a higher risk of premature birth, small for gestational age, and neonatal death. And of course, it could also have to do with the risk of thrombosis, which is much higher during pregnancy, and this is especially a risk in our Fontan women. And we do know that the Virchow's triad is especially in pregnancy present. And of course, if you have adult congenital heart disease, these risks are higher. You have often cyanosis. Pregnancy is absolutely a risk factor. And of course, with all this material, these surgical scars, prosthetic valves, you have a much higher risk of thrombosis. And especially with the Fontan, the classic Fontan, you have a very high risk of venous stasis, atrial arrhythmias, ventricular dysfunction. So these are all risk factors and a much higher risk of thrombosis. So then how to deliver these women? Is a planned cesarean section beneficial? And we could look into this in the ROPAC study, is on a patient case control study. And that was possible because in one country there was a much higher rate of the use of cesarean section compared to another country. So first we looked into the background use of cesarean section per country. And I'm not sure if you are aware of this because I wasn't before I was into this topic. But the use of cesarean section in Italy in normal women without heart disease is 40%. And in the Netherlands, this is 14%. And in Spain, I think it's a bit in the middle, it's about 26%. So what happens when the woman has heart disease? The use of cesarean section increases, but it increases in one country much more than in another country. So for instance, in Italy, it went up to nearly 60%. In the Netherlands to 19%, but in Russia there was not a high use, but in women with heart disease, the use of cesarean section was 80%. So probably the doctors are more afraid, or the distance to the hospital is further away, so they are not so very reluctant to wait for a vaginal delivery. Of course, local circumstances play an important role in this. But therefore, we could combine the outcome of vaginal delivery and cesarean section in comparable women, and we found no differences. We did found that in cesarean section, we had more bleedings, mere bleeding complications, and a higher risk of infection. But there were no advantages of cesarean section. So So indeed, I think the advice to use of vaginal delivery is very valid. So I think in congenital heart disease, what is also an important message that in most cases, pregnancy goes very well. So we also have to reassure many women, because we cannot only say that this is a problem. I think in many cases, pregnancy is tolerated well, although they can be afraid to become pregnant. So we really should discuss this, very important. On the aorta pathology, so if the ascending aorta is above 45 in Marfan patients or above 50 in patients with a bicuspid valve, the advice is not to become pregnant. And then finally, for a mechanical valve, this is a very difficult topic, and I think it's very funny, because if you have complex congenital heart disease, many cardiologists refer to a center with expert knowledge of congenital heart disease. But if the woman has a mechanical valve, most doctors feel that they can treat this patient very well because they know how it works. But in fact, the outcomes are not so good. What to do with the anticoagulation? That is the problem. We know that oral anticoagulants is bad for the baby. You have a risk of fetal toxicity, especially when you use it between 6 and 9 weeks of pregnancy. While low molecular weight heparins are not completely safe for the mother with a higher risk of thrombosis. So also in the ROPEC study, we could see the patients with mechanical heart valves, and we had 212 women with a mechanical valve. Most had a mitral valve, but also some combination of aortic and mitral valve. And here are the complications. We compared the patient with a mechanical valve versus the patient without a valve prosthesis but had heart disease. And you can see that the maternal mortality was higher, thrombotic events were higher, but especially bleeding events were very high, 23% of major bleedings, and a higher risk of miscarriage. And if you look a little bit more in detail, we compared mechanical valves versus tissue valves versus no prosthetic valve, you could see that the patient with mechanical valve have a much lower live birth outcome. And there were also many complications, that only 58% of the women with a mechanical heart valve had an uncomplicated pregnancy with a live child. So really we have to do something about this. Therefore, the ROPEC, normal ROPEC has stopped now, but we have permission now to continue with women with aortic pathology or women with a prosthetic valve. So we only will include these two groups in the new ROPEC, and all of you are very much invited to join, and we really need larger numbers, so hopefully we will finally know what is the best way to deal, especially for instance with these mechanical valves. So in conclusion, I think pre-pregnancy counseling is crucial. We have to discuss the risks for the mother, the risks for the baby, the inheritance risk, the medication, and also the long-term expectations. For instance, if you have a woman with severe heart disease with a very reduced life expectancy, this is also important to discuss, because the baby, well, I think she needs her mother at least until she is 18. And if the mother is already dead when she is 6 years of age, this is also very important to discuss, but very difficult to discuss. I think many congenital patients are at low risk, but we should discuss all our high-risk patients in the pregnancy heart team and also prepare a plan during pregnancy. And I think pregnancy should not exceed 40 weeks because there is no advantage of that. Vaginal delivery remains first choice in most of the women. Thank you very much for your attention.